Thank you all for being here. My name is Ziad Jamal, and I'll be moderating the event this afternoon. Gisa at the Venice Biennale is a series of short presentations by Gisa Packett and alumni who have participated either as curators or exhibitors at the 2018 Architecture Biennale in Venice, which, as you might remember, was titled Free Space and was created by Graf-Kunst architects. The four exhibitions we'll see and discuss this afternoon, namely the Bahrain Pavilion, the Slovenia Pavilion, and the two of the exhibits of the US Pavilion, all of them probe and bring to the fore critical cultural, architectural, and landscape issues that are connected with the built and natural environment of our cities today. From the question of religious rituals as a political practice in public space, to the threat and potentials of living with water, to global energy production, consumption, and its unequal distributions, all the way to the environmental degradation of the coast of our cities. But the four exhibitions also successfully problematized, in my opinion, and in different ways, the larger challenges that Biennale events posit today. For one, they all push back against the question of representation of the self to the other or by the other, especially in a national pavilion venue, which one can argue is really descendant of the 19th century international fair traditions. And it's through this challenge that they open space for further and more substantive explorations outside the geographical bound of the nation they represent. Consequently, they all perhaps have either successfully negotiated with or were able to circumvent the authority body that is sponsoring the work and which a national pavilion was originally perhaps meant to represent. Which really brings up the largest institutional challenge, and perhaps we can discuss that later this afternoon, which is how can we constructively contest the larger project of cultural biennales that cities often see today, so we see an explosion in biennales, triennales, design weeks, and expos. One can claim that the architecture biennale is in effect an urban phenomenon in by itself, a large autonomous institution that lands on a city every 2 years or so to become itself a consumptive entity that is slowly but radically transforming the cities in its wake. So I'll stop here, and with that I'll introduce the speakers in the order of appearance. First we have Noah Kelly, who's an architect, curator, and a researcher working in New York and Amman, and was the creator of the Bahrain Pavilion in collaboration with Marseille. The pavilion was titled Friday Sermon. She graduated from GSAP CCCP program in 2011 and became the director of CBX Online since 2012. She currently teaches across the Architecture and Urban Design program here at the school and is a member of the Center for Palestinian Studies at Columbia University, and also serves on the steering committee of the Sijal Institute for Arabic Language and Culture. Next, we'll have Abika Rebek, who is the principal of Some Place, a design studio located in New York City and Vienna, focusing on architecture and exhibition projects. She co-authored and designed the Slovenian pavilion titled Living with Water. Vika graduated from GSAP CCCP program in 2015 and currently teaches visual studies in the MR program. She's a Knight Foundation Fellow at New Inc., where she's developing a collaborative digital platform for exhibition design called Tools for Show. Then we have Dare Rowley, who is an assistant director at the Center for Spatial Research and exhibition collaborator of the US Pavilion titled In Plain Sight. She's currently a student in the Urban Planning Program. There we'll be speaking with Gerka Vasic, who's an architect. He was an associate research scholar at the Center for Spatial Research and is now at the Center for Resilient Cities and Landscapes. He was also an exhibition collaborator of the US Pavilion in Plain Sight. Prior to joining GSAP, Yuga was a researcher at Harvard Urban Theory Lab. He received a Master in Design Studies from Harvard GSP. Next, we have Kate Orff, who is an associate professor here at the school, director of the Urban Design Program, and the director of the new Center for Resilient Cities and Landscapes. He's also the founder of the landscape architecture and urban design practice SCAPE, and an exhibitor of the US Pavilion titled Ecological Citizens. K Kate will be presenting with Alberto Ross, who traveled from Venice to attend this event. Alberto is a professor at the University of Padova, where he leads the Environmental Systems Analysis Lab Research Group. He has collaborated with Kate on the exhibition for the S Pavilion. With a background in ecological modeling and engineering, his research over the past 12 years has focused on sustainable solutions to manage human activities and their environmental impacts, especially in coastal zone. Finally, I just would like to mention that unfortunately we will miss the presentation by Jawahar Al-Sudaiki, who is also a GSAP graduate from the Urban Planning Program, and was the first curator of the Saudi Arabian Pavilion in Venice this past year. Jawahar unfortunately could not make it due to the delay in getting her US visa. So please help me welcome Jawahar.
Thanks to Yad and everyone who put this together. It's really great to be able to have this conversation here at the school. So I'm going to try and be as fast as possible and read really quickly. If it's too fast, please tell me to slow down. Okay, so the Bahrain Pavilion in Venice this year took on as a topic the Friday sermon, Khutbat al-Jum'ah in Arabic. I co-curated the pavilion with Nour al-Saleh, and we worked with Batul al-Sheikh, Maryam al-Jumaidi, and Izam Sivri, who's also a graduate of the CCP program here at GSAP, on the research for the project. And of course, everything that I'll present is the product of this collaboration, and also our work with the designers, sound and visual artists, translators, engineers, and builders that contributed to the exhibition in the fork. A religious ritual organized by oratory practice, the Friday sermon, or khutbah, has historically played an important role in the shaping of collective life, public opinion, and common space for Muslim communities. Every Friday, and in every Jami'a Masjid, or mosque assembly in the world, the imam delivers a speech before the Friday noon prayer, Salat al-Jum'ah. The weekly gathering of publics on Fridays for prayer and the associated sermon is what gives the day its name, Jum'ah, or assembly in Arabic. For believers, the Friday khutbah is a regular pulse of collective listening on the social and political conditions of the time. The khutbah takes root in a pre-Islamic Arab tradition of epic poem and speech recitation, and is considered to be the source of the prose genres of Arabic literature. In Mecca, the poems known as the Mu'allaqat, suspended odes, or hanging poems, were recognized by being hung on the walls of the Temple of the Kaaba. The ritual continued during the early days of Islam, gathering people around the mosque for the Friday sermon, and eventually giving shape to planned congregational spaces in Islamic cities that would accommodate the gatherings. The Friday Mosque, or Mosque of Assembly, has been at the center of city planning as one of the most important public spaces hosting congregations beyond the religious. Political, economic, and social issues would be discussed there. The link between the central courtyard, the Sahn, and other public functions, including the houses of power and an integrated network of public spaces, enhances the importance of the mosque within the urban, social, and political structure of the city. And in these networks of spaces for congregation and assembly, power is exercised, but also contested through speech. The content of the sermon can range from hygienic recommendations to calls for non-alliance with Western powers, from patriarchal preaching to strategies for facing the Muslim ban. In times of intensified struggles for freedom, speech, and their oppression, it's not only productive but necessary to consider both the violence and the possibilities that are embedded in the architecture and the medium of the khutbah. While the prayer is a repetitive and constant marker gathering crowds for collective worship, the sermon itself transforms every week. The sites of the Friday sermon create the network of spaces temporarily activated through mass assembly. When it's considered as a network, from Bahrain to Venice and New York to Jerusalem, the spaces of the khutbah, both where it is uttered and where it is heard, are the Muslim cities' spaces and spheres of appearance. The stages where the struggle and negotiation for representation is practiced. As such, the spaces of the khutbah, whether in the boundaries of the mosque or in public spaces, become the sites of possibility for what Jayla bin Habib refers to as the practice of democratic iterations, where the limits of political membership and visibility are constantly and repeatedly challenged and reconsidered. This ritual of mass gathering provides the infrastructure for a public collective expression of dissent, and protests from Jerusalem to Cairo and from Istanbul to Gaza are organized to follow the khutbah. They are often pronounced not only in the gathering of bodies in space, but also in the content of the speech itself. In some cases, the khutbah, as a religious, social, and political right, and as an apparatus of speech and of listening, has the potential for dissent embedded within it. Where Muslim groups are targeted, it is itself a targeted gathering, and its very occurrence becomes a form of civil dissent. In the next three sections, I will be reading from the research developed by Hizam Sifri, a collaborator from here, from GSAR. In Egypt, too, the politics of the Friday sermon are intertwined with state politics. The most consequential sermon instances were the ones delivered by Gamal Abdel Nasser in Cairo on November 1956, announcing the nationalization of the Suez Canal. While delivered by the representative of an autocratic government, the sermon was a facilitator of anti-colonial mobilization. It was delivered from the balcony pulpit and amplified through loudspeakers to large audiences and resulted in a nationwide protest. Public life in Cairo, which had previously retreated from open space to private sphere after the coup in 52, was reactivated through the sermon as a theater for nationalist mobilization. Founded in the 1930s and risen to become the most prominent black nationalist organization in the late 50s, the Nation of Islam sermons reflected the oppressive US policies on African Americans and the resulting resistance. The surveillance of Muslims in the United States is not a recent practice, and the decades preceding 9/11, the state apparatus of surveillance heavily targeted black Muslims. The letters exchanged between the organization and the ministers on what ought to be preached at the sermons show that the organization was aware of the state surveillance and urged its members to keep the peace while continuing to struggle for freedom. The emergence of Malcolm X as a prominent figure in the Nation of Islam marked an important moment for the call for self-determination and equality for all. His sermons, especially in the 1963 and 1964, as he was leading the organization, addressed not only the struggles for the liberation of black Muslims, but of all black Americans. During the Gezi protest in Istanbul in 2012, Gezi Park was transformed into a communicative platform. The addition of various temporary functions, such as the infirmary and bookstore, further activated the park and established a solidarity front against government intervention. Alongside resistance on the streets and in the square, another kind of protest was the Friday sermon delivered in the park. This khutbah counteracted the state-sponsored official sermon and produced a new religious narrative. A megaphone compensated the absence of a pulpit. Its slightly buzzing soundscape contributed to the emanation of a political message. In all of these instances, the sermon takes the ritual to its limits. The physical boundaries of the ceremony expand beyond the confines of the mosque, and the minbar takes on multiple forms. Transcending the space of religion, the power of the khutbah is derived from the persuasion and eloquence of the khatib, or preacher's oratory, together with the gathering of bodies around it, the sound technologies and reach of its transmission, even the extent of its distortion. When thinking about free space, and by extension, free speech for Arab and Muslim communities, the Friday khutbah becomes a key protagonist. So what is the architecture of the Friday sermon, and how does it shape its influence and reach? From the choice of the imam, to the mechanisms that control the speech, to the minbar the preacher stands on, the loudspeakers that propagate their voice beyond the confines of the mosque and into the streets and living rooms. What are the possibilities of the khutbah when considered as a sphere of appearance, a weekly ritual of democratic iterations through collective horizontal speech and hearing in common? And what transformations can we imagine that would render the khutbah not only as an obstruction, but more as a reinforcement to the possibilities for free spaces of assembly? The Friday Sermon Project is a compilation of installation, texts, and sound compositions. And I will go through as quickly as possible the contributions to the exhibition in the book. Part of the installation is a 12-minute film by Lawrence Abu Hamdan, the Lebanese artist, the sound artist, titled The All Hearing. The issue of hearing damage and noise pollution is so present in Cairo that it was immediately accepted as a topic for a Friday sermon, when Lawrence proposed this idea to sheikhs in the city. There was a new law that militarized, that the military instilled to control the delivery of sermons by enforcing weekly topics that are sanctioned by the government. Despite that, the two sheikhs he spoke with were even more determined to have the issue of noise heard. And not only to the congregation inside the mosque, but also to all the passersby who were exposed to the mosque's loudspeakers broadcasting into the streets outside. The military crackdown on the amplified voices of the city is done in the name of policing noise and the lawless terrain of the loudspeaker, yet it is in fact simply a means to stop people from uttering anything against the government or anything that they do not want heard. Matilde Cassani is an Italian architect and researcher that has been studying sacred spaces for some years in Italy. Her installation in the pavilion is called Four Unknown Types of Minbar and Their Historical Significance. Since Islam is not officially recognized in Italy, sacred spaces have grown from within secular buildings, the interiors, and so the minbar respond to this reality. Matilde studied and represented a book on the various minbar types and mosques in Italy and presented full-scale models of four that represent the three recurring elements, the chair, the steps, and the gate. Similarly to the project by Lawrence Abu Hamdan, this installation also engages with the sermon directly as a practice. It doesn't merely study the ritual from the outside, but interferes in the way the sermon is delivered. Three Scores and the People's Mic Khutbah was commissioned with Sadia Shirazi, Pakistani based in New York, and Nezma Tatu, Palestinian based in Oxford. The project works to slowly, carefully, and actively change the way sermons are performed, having them include voices that are usually unheard. In the long run, this is a project that can affect the architecture of the sermon itself. They describe the project as a book of scores, a manual of the organization of bodies. It responds to social life under conditions of siege, imprisonment, disappearance, deportation, and surveillance. The book is a manual for Friday sermons that are inclusive, without hierarchies, and most importantly, feminized. In it, they imagine how we might gather and speak aloud together. The book is translated in Urdu, Arabic, and English, and Italian, and is the basis of a series of performances, some without audiences, and some of which we will be conducting in Venice with Muslim communities, the closing week of the Biennale. The largest and most immersive part of the exhibition is a sound installation by two artists, Italian composer and musician Giuseppe Galassi and Iraqi musicologist and composer Khayyam Illani. The first is a 17-minute piece by Giuseppe that was composed between March and May 2018 and created from recordings collected every Friday during those months from Bahrain. The sounds were recorded from inside mosques and from their surroundings, incorporating all disturbances and distortions. The sounds were edited, electronically transformed, layered, and multiplied, and combined to obtain an 8-channel soundscape. While artificial, it also reflects the polyphonic sound world of both experienced and imagined sermons on Fridays around noon, from as near as footsteps, exhales, and commentary. And while this piece is continuous for the duration of the Biennale, Khayyam Illani's piece interrupts it every Friday at 12. Working in the same field recordings, Khayyam's piece refers to the expansive reach that this ritual has as it travels with time and covers the entire globe on Friday, anywhere the clock hits noon. Khayyam, too, focused on the pauses between phrases, the noises, and the breathing between them. As moments also, he exploded the sermon out of its expected an all-too-familiar male voice. The two pieces were installed in a structure designed by Apparata, a London-based design firm, and the space creates host sound installations, but also makes room for experimentation and enactment and rehearsal of alternative formats for the sermon itself, including the enactments of the work of Sadi Shirazi and Nezma Tatu. Giuseppe and Khayyam also performed live in the same space. I'm really over time, right? Okay. So I'll just mention that there was a video by Architectures of Refusal with Rob Lorega that combined all of the work from the editorial statement and installations in the book together, and then as well a book with contributions from Hizam Sibri, Matthew Degassani, Ziad Jamaluddin, Mustafa Al-Kharouf, and many others.
Hi everyone, it's so nice to be here, and I just spotted a few friends and colleagues, and especially Tim, who was a collaborator throughout the whole process of that 1 year of time working on the Venice Biennale. So I'm happy to be here with all of you. So, living with water, that was the topic that was actually given to us by the commissioner and the curator of the Pavilion, Matthias Cselik. And you know, he put together a diverse team of landscape architects, publishers. It was an open call, so we all applied and really came from different corners, living in London, New York, Indiana, all kinds of some connections with Slovenia. But it was challenging to actually, in this very wide topic, to come up with a solution. And after a year of putting our heads together and really thinking hard about the topic, we came up with a fountain. And so, you know, how did we get there? I'll actually talk a little bit about kind of the background of that fountain idea and kind of architectural inspiration behind that, which goes on to a little bit of a historical tour of Richard Plečnik, which is you know, very known Slovenian, or the most famous Slovenian architect, very famous in Slovenia, not so famous anywhere else. but he designed this building in 1947, and that is, you know, it was meant to be a parliament for Slovenia, and Slovenia was still part of Yugoslavia. And so that in itself, and its size, and its sort of, you could say, weird proportion, and you know, almost like monstrous expression. It didn't get built at the time for many reasons, but it is a project that has been actually copied and brought to life in so many different ways. And it caught our attention because of one little detail which can be found at the very basement of it. So you probably can't even see it in this sketch because it's too low res, but at the very bottom of the fountain, you can see a very basically, you can see a little fountain. And when we, in our many discussions and debates of how to represent that topic, saw that fountain, we're like, okay, we're gonna just create a replica of that fountain. We're gonna create a one-to-one version. And we liked the idea that it was a parliament, it was a public, you know, it was not a public space, but something where we make decisions that affect the country. And we just realized that the topic of water is starting to affect everything. Something that really isn't something that one solution or one person can solve, or even one country can solve. It goes across borders, it goes across so many different decision makers. And so it felt like, how can we bring this topic to the Biennale and decide, okay, we want to make a public parliament. And this is going to serve as our kind of foil or inspiration or kind of formal inspiration that will create this public parliament in the exhibition. But I want to talk briefly about the history of how that icon has been used, because we're not the first ones to actually take it for our purposes, and I just found that process kind of fascinating of how a building that has never been built actually had so many different lives. And so this is a cover of the infamous band Laibach, which is, you know, kind of punk, fake Nazi band. They're not real Nazis, but they're really hard to, like, pretending to be Nazis very convincingly. There's a Slovenian band called Laibach, which is a German word for Ljubljana. And this was their album, Slovenska Popola. So they were, you know, they were the first ones to really use that section, and they wanted to be, of course, kind of ironic about it. You know, they were like, they're using this as a sort of symbol of power and classicism. And Žižek was actually, you know, the famous Slovenian philosopher. I mean, there's Slavani and Žižek, the two famous Slovenians, but Žižek was reacting to that at the time. And he, you know, he, in an interview, he said, well, you know, Laibach, of course, they're ironic, it's a joke, but Plečnik was was serious. He called him a light fascist, and he called his architecture a point of reference against functionalist modernism, against reinforced concrete utilitarian functionalist architecture, and as a basis for some kind of national foundation. And there was a really interesting interpretation later by Andrew Hirscher, who's a researcher, who said, it was Zizek, right? You know, maybe Plechnik was actually not so serious after all. Maybe he was also kind of making a joke. Or maybe he was also being a little bit ironic with his architecture. Because if you look at the section, it's actually composed of all these different styles. And it has sort of Germanic elements, it has Italian elements, and you could say it's actually built out of, sort of appropriated from central monuments of Slovenia's national enemies. So you know, he was actually drawing an interpretation that was kind of in parallel to Leibach's appropriation that Plechnik was actually also appropriating, and he was not necessarily that deadly, serious or that fascist about it. This is the album itself, so it's using the floor plan as a base, and then a column from the section as a detail. And what is crazy to me, so that was a very subversive act to use that building, but only, and you know, this album came out in 87, and only 2 years later, in 89, it was actually used on the very first currency that Slovenia kind of gained after its independence. It was very short-lived, barely a few years. It was called the Lipa, but suddenly this unbuilt building became like the national symbol of a new country, widely distributed. And that continued, so it was actually, you know, on the postmarks, and you see here independence, you know, it was like a symbol all of a sudden in the year of 91, and it's even on a euro coin. So it's really widely spread, and you know, how strange for something that never existed. And artists have also taken to it. They've decided that, you know, it's interesting that it should actually exist in Ljubljana. This is Ljubljana, it's the river that goes through the city. So this is actually a Chilean artist, Ila Quinteros, who came to Ljubljana and made a real physical replica of the parliament and floated it down the river. And then, you know, the CG people have decided that it should be rendered. And for some reason they decided that it should be all white, which is very strange because actually all the materials and all about you know, kind of expression of it. If you know Lowe's architecture, so it has some of that, you know, he uses a lot of marble and a lot of texture, so I find it very strange, but that person thought that this is appropriate. And here you start to see the kind of unmasking how little detail there is in this building, and that's part of why I think it can allow for feminine interpretations. Because you know, when you have barely a section with so little detail, everyone can just create their own story about it. And you know, I don't think that that's the correct story, but that person, the moment you render it, the moment you show so much detail, you start kind of revealing maybe too much. And then somebody made an animation out of it, which also, you know, again, is sort of revealing too much. I would love to commission somebody to do a VR at some point. I think it just needs to live on, and people need to kind of find their own interpretations of this literature. And there's still a community, there's still kind of a group that tries to get it built. That's a crazy part of me. It's actually a lobby of you know, architects and urban planners and just civic lobbyists who are actually envisioning and planning for how that project will actually live in Ljubljana right now. And it would still be one of probably the tallest building actually in Ljubljana. It's like a very, you know, small city and a giant thing in there. So back to our pavilion. So we used it as well. And we use it, you know, again, as a sort of public space where instead of this chamber of congressmen, and it was men at the time, being elevated in, you know, just in a sort of round space, our round space became flattened. We kind of condensed the section into one plane where the fountain kind of came up into the main chamber. And we really liked the idea of the fountain as this meeting spot, as this idea of, you know, the fountain of wisdom or the spot where the people, after they've had a debate or after they've made a decision, they come to the founder, and then they think about what has happened in that discussion. And how we want to simulate the discussion was actually in the columns around it. We created six extreme or controversial positions towards water that are related to the realms of economics and politics and the environment. So people were actually able to vote on these positions. So they could, for a second, be an environmentalist. For example, they could say, no, everything should just be, you know, should be protected, and we should really stop everything we're doing and need to change our system entirely. Or they could be climate change deniers. So we really wanted to paint a full picture, and they could say, no, climate change doesn't exist. They could be in favor of participatory practices where people are involved in simulating. They could be in favor of technology will solve everything. We can just, you know, because there's a lot of people who think that, so we wanted to propose this as an extreme solution as well. Or they could say, well, actually, the only person that can deal with it is the state, because they're, you know, the big hand, so they can, they don't have much power. Or ultra-libertarians were like, dear relations of a solution if you just let the free market reign and people solve everything. So, you know, we put these provocations out there, put them on the columns with an explanation and some text. And people were able to vote on them, sort of decide, you know, kind of activate those different situations. And we wanted the space to change when people vote on these positions. So the projections would, so there's basically light being flooded into the space, and it's actually first directed at the water surface, and then it kind of refracts onto the walls. That's of course hard to show in a presentation, but basically the space was constantly kind of changing, and the acoustics were changing because the fountain would turn it on and off, and so the water, you'd hear the water, and then it would stop again. This is just an illustration of sort of how we adopted the section, and how sort of the fountain came from the bottom, came up, and became this big flat ground that everyone was able to access. And this is a moment how you could approach one of these columns and activate the environment around it. And yeah, just another sort of absolute image of how it looked, kind of very stern and simple. And this was one of the visitors that really enjoyed the installation. And we, so, you know, as you see, it's a very simple installation in a way. It's something that you could almost say has no content. But we thought that Biennale is this place where there's so many people who pass through, there's so much you can see, so we wanted to do something that she can get, that's something that, you know, any person of any level can just understand intuitively. So even if you don't know about Plečnik, you know, you should be able to enjoy the space. Or if you don't care about art, you should still be able to enjoy the space. But we have brought out a really hefty catalog, and a lot of interesting people to write on the topic, and actually it's still continuing as a research project, so there's going to be an exhibition in Ljubljana on the 18th of October. I'm going to be there because I'm also doing an exhibition plan for that. And we are there really dealing with the local problems. Ljubljana is built on a marsh, and it has regular problems with flooding. And so we're, you know, uncovering all these historic maps, and it's actually really nice after this very abstract kind of global project to be working on a very local scale and very local problems. And this is going to be a conference on the 19th of October where, you know, we'll bring in experts and people to talk about the topic from that perspective. So yeah, that's it. That's what I wanted to share today. And thank you.
Hi everyone. I'm Gunnar Bašić.
And I'm Deirdre Romney.
And so for this year's U.S. Pavilion, the Center for Spatial Research was invited to join the DSI team together with Bobby Petrushko from Harvard GSD. And so we formed a really interdisciplinary team that consisted of practicing architects, cartographers, full-time researchers, and data scientists. And so we brought a lot of different things to the table. And so the overall theme of the US Pavilion this year was the dimensions of citizenship. And which means, that the architects and designers, that is urgent for us to start asking what it means to be a citizen today, and how might we express and engage in these sort of paradoxical conditions of citizenship. And so we were tasked to look at the citizenship at the scale of the globe. So different dimensions were citizens, civitas, region, nation, globe, network, and cosmos. So so our scale was the global scale. And to do so, we started interrogating two global data sets. The nighttime lights and the gridded population of the world.
Thank you.
So in other words, the absence of light does not mean the absence of people. And we found many examples of places that are dark, but that have actually large populations. And we've created sort of this internal taxonomy of these types, and those are the wealthy enclave, refugee camp, outage, city denied life, isolated village, extraction settlement, informal settlement, and indigenous territory. But each of these is just one of many such locations, and so through this process, we've actually found hundreds of such locations on the world, and we've all mapped them.
So likewise, the presence of light does not always equal the mean presence of people. So the piece goes on to sample 8 instances of this phenomenon across the world.
Thank you.
So this was the first story that emerged from interrogating these two data sets, and it really set the approach for all other case studies and stories in this piece, in that we were really interested in this kind of relationship between dark and bright locations, especially when the two are in close proximity to one another. And especially when like these conditions of lights know people and people know lights are implicated in one another. So for example, here the KOB 9 shows this bright lights know people location, but people who work in the mine live in an extraction settlement nearby that shows up as a people know lights location. And at the same time, the power is drawn from the faraway Inga Dam that bypasses large settlements that are also people know lights locations. And so we wanted to look at, these are not sort of unique standalone anomalies, and we wanted to look at other examples of such dynamics. And so for example, in Peru, the story that we will show next, we found lights know people location, which is a gas field that is encroaching in indigenous population territories, which is people know lights location.
gas or oil extraction or processing facilities across the globe in ecologically vulnerable regions. So the story of natural gas extraction in Peru really presented this complicated case where drilling in remote locations largely enabled electrification of the rest of the nation of Peru. And yet it also brought development and contamination through the gas spills into lands that were populated by indigenous peoples. And indeed, these lands, those particular settlements, which we saw sort of highlighted in green, were designated as territories after initial explorations by the Shell Corporation in the 1980s, which had documented detrimental effects on the populations who had been living there before. So by taking this approach and looking at conditions where places with lights and no people were far close or interact with places where there are people and no lights, a number of other sort of major themes emerged in these case studies and others that were presented in the piece, ranging from dependence, so tourist sites which dot coastlines and are bright spots on the map that in some cases rely on labor from nearby towns to show up as places lights, to myriad forms of displacement, to infrastructure development that privileges extraction and global wealth for their local populations, to disparities, even in places with access to electricity, between where infrastructure is repaired quickly versus where it's not at all. This last one we illustrated with a comparison between Puerto Rico and Houston in the aftermath of Hurricanes Maria and Harvey, and just how stark that story is in terms of which location had electricity restored very quickly versus not. So I think we get for two kind of times, so we'll skip past that one. But so really taken all together, these cases, stories, and patterns really present a picture of unevenness, very different from the smooth picture of a sort of connected even planet that the two images purported to show when we started. So we'll close out with the very end of the piece.
Okay, I want to start just with an anecdote. I mean, this is the United States Pavilion, and I think a lot of questions came up during this process that were, you know, the title of this exhibition is organized by Vinnie Zeiger and we, and the curatorial group was about dimensions of citizenship. And one of the early kind of dominating anecdotes from our experience with this was that basically the Trump was elected during this time, so after we submitted a kind of discussion about what it would mean to participate in this exhibition, there was a huge cloud of unknowing around whether or not our pavilion could be moving forward. And so we heard rather late in the game, and so it was really kind of, even just the act of participating in this international exhibit kind of called into question a lot of global kind of citizenship acts. I also, before I get started, wanted to say another facet of that citizenship discussion was that members of our team, who were included Namas Boron, Nami Arzamon, Pichino Burr, and Tara Montadi, the main members of our team who we were set to deploy to Venice to work on the project, both were not able to leave the country because of visa reasons. So the complexity of citizenship before we even began thinking about this project was very evident. So I mean, I guess I wanted to just restate the thesis of the US Pavilion Curators, which was this notion of understanding and exploring the notion of citizenship through the lens of scale. And scape was given, or the scale of the region. And I think, you know, another early kind of starting point for thinking about this exhibition is that scape has done a lot of works or exhibitions in museums, but we have not done biennales. And so when I heard that our group was selected and so on, there was a meeting, like, we're going to Venice. And it was like the concept of Venice was much more foregrounded than the concept of Biennale and the concept of doing a project that engaged the Venetian kind of eco-region was one that was kind of most exciting to us. But in general, our exhibition is titled Dimensions, is titled Ecological Citizenship. And through juxtaposing these three scales or scales of engagement, one which is the scale of the person or the animal in this sort of biological setting, the second scale, which if you can see on this sort of image at the top right, this much larger regional scale of ecological loss and devastation, and then third, the scale of action or implementation. We wanted to juxtapose this kind of multi-scalar approach to rethinking the region in our exhibit. And so as these videos kind of cycle through, you can see the top right is a map of literal wetland loss, and one of the things that we've been working on in our work here in the New York region, but also more around the United States and the globe, is kind of really studying regions through this lens of loss. And how to do a creative project and how to act as an architect relative to this new kind of context of loss and what it means to engage in creatively in reversing that force. So this became a kind of a subtext for all of the work. But in general, I mean, our hope was that the exhibition is really highlighting and giving agency to citizens, human and non-human alike, that make up the region. And we sort of posited this region as an area that doesn't have fixed political boundaries, but that it rather consists of these assemblages of ecosystems, interspecies entanglements, infrastructural imperatives, and climactic forces. And when the mud puppy jumps, please go to the next slide. So as much as we were kind of focusing on these five bioregions, we were really inspired by the lagoon, and we met Alberto, who's going to say some words about his work in Waikumene. And so the project became much more richer and very grounded in looking at these global case studies, but also trying to understand in a very deep way what's happening and who are the eco-citizens that are now currently working in the lagoon itself and transforming the lagoon. And the exhibition is, as you can see here, this image aimed to kind of rethink the classical architectural form about what is beautiful, for example, and really present this kind of notion of ugly ecosystem architecture that will ultimately combine together with dedicated people and citizens to begin to help regenerate these biodiverse marshlands in the larger landscape and really actually serve to play a role outside of the building's doors. So the images, the elements themselves become kind of part of the display. The elements, especially the fascines, are going to be redeployed after the close of the exhibit in November. And basically, it's this kind of juxtaposition of scales of action and impact, which is what we were really trying to highlight. And how the notion of region in the future will be made by people working together toward kind of reinventing the regional ecosystems that once defined where we are. So just some close-ups of the materiality of this kind of eco restoration tools. And I think we wanted to be very grounded and very focused on this notion of level one, not a representation of the reality of these materials, but literally kind of just to highlight them and all their kind of strange beauty and all of their texture. Also, I guess, the idea of focusing on Venice as a region or Venice as a place. place, as I guess maybe landscape architects are wont to do, really sort of made us question the idea of an exhibition that had to take place within the sort of white walls of, or in this case, gray walls of a pavilion. So we began to work with the curators on an event that would then lead people or participants out into the lagoon itself. And I don't have the right statistics, but I think we understand that in general about 75% of all of the marshlands of the lagoon have disappeared even in the last 75 years. So, you know, what does it mean to be a regional ecosystem today in this context of loss? Well, part of it is you need to share information, you need to build alliances, you need to kind of create context, you need to work in partnership with others. So a big part of what we aim to sort of participate in the Biennale was this actual act of going out into the marsh and shining a spotlight on the ecosystem citizens who are working there now and how they're working. And so we brought a group by a boat out to the Chiricosa Marsh and began to draw connections between what was happening inside the exhibition itself. In this case, you see this core logs and the fascines on the left, and how these materials are deployed to kind of fabricate marshes, because the entire lagoon itself is highly constructed over centuries. There was also this very compelling and kind of touching moment where a group composed a kind of an ode to Venice and the marshlands itself. And so this kind of place as an ecosystem became kind of foregrounded as, you know, one thinks about the Venetian architecture and culture as being kind of limited to this very small island and its signature architecture. But I think in this one instance, in particular in this case of this song that was composed, it became extremely clear that actually that culture emerged from this much larger fisherman and marsh context, and that the reciprocity between this larger regional ecosystem of the marsh and the culture of Venice itself came to the foreground. And so key on that walk was Alberto, who is here in the flesh, and here in the image. But I think we learned through working with him in Life Limine about actually the ways that even working across all of these environments, the ways that that we're working here in Jamaica Bay or Raritan Bay in terms of integrating people with regenerative ecosystems is something that is a sort of shared methodology and a shared approach. So
first of all, I would like to thank all the Escape staff involved in this project, Nanoscape, and everybody else who helped us in setting up this project, which was a great chance for us to learn about different ways to see wetland management and actually realize that they're not very different from what we do in Italy. And so I'm going to talk about the redeployment of the fascines that are shown at the Biennale, currently exhibited at the Biennale. And this is an example of ecological citizenship, which is the theme of this exhibition. So the fascines will be redeployed in the Venice Lagoon, and they will be redeployed following the approach of this European funded project, which is called Life Limine, which I coordinated over the past 4 years. It is a demonstrative project with a 2 million euro budget, which was aimed to protect submarshes in the Venice Lagoon from erosion. If you ever happen to land in the Venice airport, which is shown in the picture, and you sit in the right-hand side of the airplane, this is very important, and look out the window, you can see that landscape. If you're not lucky enough to make a trip to Venice soon, you could open Google Earth and just zoom, and you could see that landscape. Those are the submarshes we're protecting in the project. And this picture is very important because it shows that this fractal-like landscape is continuously evolving, it is dynamic. And so you have to find conservation techniques which are fit to protect a very dynamic environment without fragility in a static state. And that's what we try to do in this project. These are how submarshes look if you go within them. These are not Atlantic submarines, these are Mediterranean ones, where the tidal range is like this, okay? So, and these ecosystems exist in the tidal range, in particular in the upper part of the tidal range, where they exist in 20 centimeters, not below, not above. So they're very delicate, they're very prone to erosion. We have to find out proper conservation techniques to protect this ecosystem from erosion without basically destroying what you're trying to protect with big mechanical means and ships and boats and so on. And the inspiration for our project was the long-term human natural relationship that is present in the Laguna of Venice. You know that the Laguna of Venice is a world heritage site, and the site is called Venice and its lagoon, which are recognized as inseparable whole by UNESCO. The city of Venice exists in the lagoon because of the lagoon. The lagoon provided Venetian with shelter, with food, with salt, and in turn, Venetians took care of the lagoons. Of the lagoon over the centuries. They even deviated rivers out of the lagoon to prevent the lagoon from silting up. Okay? But now, and still today, the lagoon is providing the Venetian society with benefits, for example, fish and opportunities for recreation. And however, there's a huge environmental crisis going on in the Venice lagoon, and this is site marsh erosion. Basically, over the past century, 72% of the surface of these habitats, protected habitats, have disappeared and erosion is accelerating. And this is not the only reason why this human-natural relationship is breaking down. The social fabric is eroding because people are leaving the lagoon islands because it's complex to live there. There are no jobs, modern lifestyles are difficult to carry on in an isolated island such as those found in the middle of the lagoon. And this means not only a problem for the people, but the loss of cultural heritage, because these people carry out fishing with traditional techniques that have been there for centuries, for millennia. And so this is a huge problem which we try to address in the project, in particular by targeting the innermost submarines, as we call them. That is the submarines where the water is so shallow, like this, that you really can't use classical conservation techniques, because otherwise you're going to disturb or to spend too much money protecting this ecosystem. So you have to think about alternative ways of protecting these places from erosion. And that's, before talking about these ways, I would like to make a statement which seems a bit theoretical, but in the end it will become clear. And it is that erosion causes our socioeconomic at their very root. For example, erosion in the Venice Lagoon is caused by it's caused by speeding motorboats. That's a picture, okay, of the way it's breaking down so much is caused by the speeding motorboat. Erosion is caused by the excavation of deep channels to allow cargo ships enter the Venice Lagoon and reach the port. And so like we may try to tackle erosion also on the socio-economic level, because this was equally important to us. And the solutions were fascists. This is a picture of a system that we placed in the northern Venice Lagoon. That is a nature-based solution, so we created a system made of branches we placed along the edges of the submarines to protect them from waves and to retain sediments. And this is very important because wood is biodegradable, so these fascines are able to protect submarines, but they don't last forever, so they don't freeze the submarines in a static form. They're not like rock protections, which are commonly used in the lagoon. And this is another picture with low tide. And very important, on the bottom you can see a net, a fishing net. And in a moment it will become clear why that net is important. And this is the Church of Buran in the north of Venice Lagoon. That church has been there for centuries. And we also used mud, so we carried out so-called sediment nourishment. So we pumped mud. Very small scale works, of course. This is the biggest work that we have done, which is 100 square meters. And we pump mud to restore submarine surfaces and to the proper, very tiny, height level, allowing plant to grow. Because if you pump too much mud, plants won't grow. And if you pump too little, you won't restore the submarine. And this small scale is very important because it's related to low environmental impact in this very delicate context. And we tried to create
works only where they were strategic to stop erosion. This picture is a very good example. We constructed this barrier to protect this mud flat and all the submarsh behind it from the Bora wind, which are very strong northeast wind, which are coming from this direction. So by protecting this very tiny stretch of salt marsh, you are actually indirectly protecting all of this habitat. These are our workers that are working. And the other point is that we try to act in a prevention-based approach. So every time we saw a problem, our workers saw a problem in the field, we try to act as soon as possible to stop erosion before it became out of control and too expensive to control. And this is basically, from the technical point of view, what we did. And you may guess that acting in a prevention-based approach and using biodegradable materials, of course, has a huge problem. And that is that your workers have to be there continuously to monitor the salt marshes, to take care of the protections and maintain them and repair them and fix them whenever needed. And so this may be very expensive. So how can this be sustainable? And it's a very hard job, by the way. You see, you work in the middle of the water. And this is sustainable, and we show that by involving local communities in the works. And what we did in practice was to hire local fishermen from the islands of Burano, Torcello, and Mazzorgo to install, to monitor, and to repair, to maintain these protections. These are two of our fishermen, Bruno and Stefano. And why fishermen? Because this has so many advantages. One is that they live near salt marshes, so they can just carry out the continuous monitoring that's needed to implement a prevention-based approach. The second reason is that they know the lagoon very well, because it's not very easy to navigate in water like that. I never tried to go there with the low tide, because I would remain there until the high tide. Okay? And so they are more efficient than us. The third reason is that you create local jobs, so you contrast this social erosion I was talking about and this cultural heritage loss, because these are traditional fishermen. And the fourth reason is that you, by involving these people, carry out indirect divulgation. And these people have proved to be very proactive in suggesting us ways to improve this protection. So this is basically a win-win solution. And from this project, which lasted for 4 years, in the end we were able to conclude that protecting the salt marsh through this, we call it integrated, so technical, but also social approach, there are several advantages. Protecting the salt marsh with this approach means protecting not only biodiversity, not only the traditional lagoon landscape, which is salt marshes, not only the ecosystem services that the salt marsh provide men with, such as carbon sequestration, nutrient abatement, fishery support, and so on, but also you protect the local businesses which depend on salt marshes. Without salt marshes, there would be no traditional fishing, of course, because the lagoon would be a sea. There would be no ecotourism, and these businesses have a value which you can calculate. And it also means creating and protecting new local jobs in conservation. So if you make the calculation, very rough calculation, and you calculate the value of the benefits and the value of the cost of this approach, and you make the ratio, we found out that it was at least 9.5%, and it's a very conservative estimate. I don't know about banks in the US, but there is no bank in Europe where you can invest 1 euro and get 9.5 euro back in a short time. So the conclusion of this project is that all it was a new human natural alliance is possible in the Venice Lagoon, and I think this is a good example of ecological citizenship. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We're very late, so I'm just going to start.
To a high degree, all projects have challenged this idea of one national identity, per se, in different ways. So, I mean, I think this Slovenian Ladino, for instance, continues to kind of unpack or demystify that national narrative of that moment. But also, I guess, taking water as a topic, the body of water obviously challenges when you think about aquifer, groundwater, or watershed, already kind of challenges the idea of national boundary or a nation state. I think, even in the case of Nora's by the survey, I mean, you already demonstrated it's not geographically specific, so that kind of practice happens across the world, but you also, I guess, making the case that it's not culturally specific, meaning that it's not necessarily bound to one religious practice, and by doing that, I think you're unlocking its potentials. I think the Ukraine site is obviously a kind of global research project, but it's also very much based on the local pixel, kind of the localized pixel. And I think I remember when I was there, when you zoom in on Puerto Rico and you see the darkness, you've already been kind of this global research, making it, I guess, relevant again with the national scale, if you want to talk about it today, for instance. And obviously, I think the title of ecological citizenship, citizen is already kind of calling for some kind of universal citizenship that is somehow ecologically conscious but also active, right? So it's not only about understanding but also about acting in this very moment. So I'm wondering if you can just very quickly go through the challenges, perhaps, or even the freedom that you had in negotiating with the authority or with whoever was at the end of the day kind of sponsoring and making that project happen.
Okay, yes, but in the case of him, our strategy was to make sure that we address a lot of the very problematic realities in relation to freedom of speech, and also particular to the Friday sermon. By addressing it on a global scale that is specific to a particular kind of ritual that happens all over the world in Muslim communities. The issue of freedom of speech, specific to Bahrain, was kind of the elephant in the room throughout. So by not tackling it and being subjected to being stopped, we actually ended up having that as the primary issue that was expected to be there and so was constantly thought about. And also in relation to all of the places that the team, which is a team of people working in New York, in Amman, in Lebanon, in Cairo, was thinking about it in their own local hometowns or where they were living, but also specific to Venice, considering the fact that Islam is not recognized, and the work that we did both with Sadia and Esna in the score book, but also with working with Italian architecture researchers, studying that issue specifically in Italy. So it was specific to Bahrain, but making sure that we...
It's almost like multiplying the nations around it, if you talk about the specific condition.
Yeah, and I think one of the main issue was having that elephant in the room that was expected.
It was empty.
Yeah.
I mean, it was filled with the
sound.
Yeah, I can speak to that a little bit. I mean, for me, it was on a personal level, interesting because I haven't lived in Slovenia since I'm a small child. And so I feel like and actually a few team members were kind of like that, they lived abroad. And so I think as a team, we brought a different sensibility and we're actually criticized a little bit for using Pechnik because people have seen it so much. And they're like, oh, why again? But you know, I felt that it was actually really appropriate for this global stage in a way and that people would from outside, if they would learn about it or find out about it. We had like an image of like a section in the book as well, you know, that maybe they would become interested and fascinated by that. So I felt like, you know, in that context, it was not something that people have seen a million times before, but in the context of Slovenia, it was. And there was also an expectation, people were wanting to see more specific concrete projects, because, you know, that was all in the book, but that's why I asked people who were like, why is it not an exhibition? And so there's definitely a little bit of feedback. I hope that the show in Vienna is going to actually appease some of these critics. And I, in a way, I agree, or I can see why people think that, but I still kind of stand firm on the minimalism of the installation, actually. And, you know, there were two sides. There were people who really enjoyed and commented. And I have to say, the commissioner gave us all the freedom. I never felt any pressure or I had to navigate politically around things. It was always like, it was great, because in the process, that was never an issue, and I was never worried about, I was only worried about all the people that will come from all over the world. I wasn't really worried about the Slovenian kind of audience. But then when I was there, actually, because there's so much happening, the ones that are coming are all the local people, the local media, you know, they're, because everyone else is busy covering and with all the other things that are going on. So actually, it became weirdly local when I was there, and everyone was kind of sticking to their own people. It's just too much to take in. So yeah, it was a nice balance. But again, I'm happy we're doing the second round to kind of back it up with the physical and the local. And, yeah.
I mean, two more minutes on just the American context. I think the curators did an amazing job by expanding the agency of the architect and understanding how these multiple scales, whether it's globe, region or, you know, Civitas kind of begin to interact. I think the immediate, like, I did a little bit of press around it, and the immediate thing was like, what about the wall? And so that is the kind of layperson's, you know, immediate kind of understanding of what it means to be an architect in this era. Like, do you build the wall? Do you not build the wall? But I feel like the curators did a really amazing job of making it really thick and layered discussion and not having it be one-liner.
That's one small thing to add on to that, we are also in the same context. I definitely felt like our team felt fairly insulated from any kind of concern about that, with real gratitude with the curators. But I think, going back to your point, Kate, the way that they commissioned works that used many different types of media in order to interrogate that question really contributed to that. Team the comprehensive architects as well as data scientists doing work that primarily happened in analysis in GIS and like programming languages sort of contributed to that multiple types of engagement with the question.
We did have a lot of discussions at the beginning and what it means to represent United States in 2018 and how political and critical we should be, and it was almost too easy to be overly critical. So that was one of the early sort of issues. And then later on, the challenge was very simple, is how do you do this in such a short deadline? Because apart from the video itself, there's actually a research project, just like any other project we do at the center, and with its own research methodologies and necessary rigor, which sometimes we just had to juggle with and maybe even compromise in order to get stories through.
Yeah, I think the answer a little bit speaks to the state of the governing affairs in the other world and the rest, and maybe this extra burden that the Arab state has to be somewhat presented, but I mean, even nationalism is becoming even more popular in the West today, and I think you all had to deal with this question. Presenting the nation, but I mean, which is really the legacy of what the International Fair has delivered to us, a national really representing one place.
Can I add something? I think it's more not so much the burden of having to represent, but the responsibility to make sure that even though you're being sponsored by the state, I mean, you know, being able to somehow navigate through that and put forward the critique that you think is necessary to make. I think it wasn't so much running away from representation, but actually pursuing a particular kind of representation that wouldn't compromise your position.
Yeah.
And that was, I think, the most difficult part.
I still get the proof. I guess, which is really brings us to the second larger question concerning the form of the exhibition, and possibility, perhaps, of questioning the physical relationship of the Biennale to the city of this context. And I was also making that observation that those cultural events
I feel like all four exhibitions somehow called for means of engagement towards the city, whether it was city Venice as a context or its own context in more general terms. So the active water fountain kind of allowed the visitor to build consensus, I guess, almost like a democratic platform, consensus in making the urban, I guess, deciding the urban policies that would affect the city. I think in plain sight, I was you know, wondering if you can assume that your lens of energy sensing lens on Venice itself during the exhibition, what would that have shown? Because it's still populated, but what kind of populations are there? And at what time? Obviously, Venice is becoming more kind of a seasonal touristic destination that is continuously being drained out of its inhabitants at the expense, obviously, of its ecology. And I think, Noah, in your in the exhibition, you're also distributing those books, Autobahn books, kind of disseminating this idea of free speech, of perhaps encouraging oral contestation in the public space. And I was kind of also reminded that while the exhibition was happening, right outside the doors of the Biennale, there were all these vocal activists kind of calling for their right in the city, almost kind of taking the page of this textbook that you were also putting out. So there's a sense of engagement. And very clearly so with ecological citizens, it's not anymore about calling to action, it's actually acting on the city at this very specific moment where the exhibit became not an exhibition, it's really kind of a storage or a staging area for deploying those raw material on site and kind of started already this act of repairing the landscape. So I just would like to hear from you as curators and exhibitors, what if you think that maybe in the next Biennale, maybe in what you have done already, if this is important for us to start thinking about the exhibition, not only in terms of being prefabricated and important, but also kind of grounding itself and perhaps asking that cultural institution, which is Biennale in this case, to be perhaps either more responsible or more conscious of their impact on that city.
Yeah, thanks for your question. It was very much a debate. Our team also with a fountain, people were saying, Venice has so many fountains, why are you building another fountain? And the initial, or at some stage of the project, we really wanted to reach out to Venice and build things in the canal that people could vote, have voting stations all over the cities, because it makes so much sense, right? It's about water, water, right? It's a water city. It was just one of these things where you had to cut down and make one simple. I mean, we had, if you talk about constraints, we had an extremely low budget. Like, we had the budget that other countries have for their party. So, you know.
Or their vote.
Yeah, so, you know, that's also something that people don't have to talk about, but it's like a huge issue for a small country that doesn't have a budget that needs to spend most of the money on actually renting the space and then not very much stuff over. But yeah, if I ever get to do a Biennale again, I think that's a very valid question. I would love to engage the city, and it is painful to see Venice. I went back in October, or actually early November with my grandmother, and I'm curious if it's still as busy or if that's going to be a more calm time then. But I think, you know, there's setting up, it was actually nice because then you met all the local contractors and you met all the people who are actually employed, who are maybe not Venetian, but they're Italian architects that come there and build all the pavilions. And you know, from Sweden, I just jumped over and it's like a 2-hour drive, so we were able to actually locally build everything. But some people really pre-built everything far away and then shifted over. So I think that's its own exhibition, all these narratives of how things are made and brought to Venice and how ecological those institutions actually are. And yeah, I think, you know, let's see what the next commissioner, the Biennale commissioner does, but I think that would be a fascinating topic. Yeah.
I think that it is very important that exhibitions like the Biennale try to engage with citizens and researcher, so I'm not an architect, but the project that we worked on now okay, plans to redeploy these bassins in the Northern Laguna. That's very important because most Venetians, and in particular people from the islands, think that research exhibitions are all the cultural life that's ongoing in the city is not really contributing to their welfare, to the good of the lagoon. And but actually, most research, most conservation projects that have been funded by the EU over the past 4 years, 5 years in the lagoon, just like Vimina, but many others, were written by research institutes. Okay, because we have a huge problem of institutional fragmentation. There are too many institutions in charge of managing the lagoon, so you have to be able to tackle complexity, to deal with complexity, and to act to address this fragmentation and do good things for the city. And it's only, I think it's researcher, it's cultural events that can just foster the kind of, this kind of change in the city that's very much needed.
I mean, that was the original intent behind the sculpture movement, to rejuvenate the city with a little kind of boost of energy at a certain point, but at this point it's almost like draining the city as opposed to kind of.
And that was my, I've never been to the Biennale, so I felt like, at one hand, just with fresh eyes, I felt like it was overwhelming, the amount of just architectural production that had gone. I mean, I think about Nans, and I think about, you know, Verga and Dare, and people like Pet, just working late nights, and like, the sheer amount of just models and text and drawings, and the, what it takes to do all of that. And so that was overwhelming on the one hand, just kind of be in that space and just feel like you're a part of this global community. And, but on the other hand, I, even though, you know, yes, the flight there in and of itself is probably not the most sustainable kind of thing, but every time I walked by somewhere, I was handed a plastic champagne flute, and then it would just be like piles of, so it did, there was this moment of actual revulsion, frankly, for me personally, about like just this kind of like incredible kind of consumptive nature of what it is. So I certainly feel like there's, yeah, that there has to be a, there has to be a more creative way or a different way of kind of carrying on the passionate creativity that is the architectural instinct, but not kind of having such a raw display of, I don't know, it's not hedonism because that's like way over at the top, but it sort of feels like that at the moment. After you have your fifth plastic champagne flute in a day, and then it's like, okay, it's stop. And it just feels, you know, I felt strangely like, you know, our team was also looking at Airbnbs, and it's like, wow, most of Venice is an Airbnb, you know, and that feels like it's kind of a hollowing out of the city that has happened rather than this rejuvenation to your earlier point.
The other, aspect was that the protest that you mentioned, which we lost from the experts, it was addressing the fact that this curatorial statement of free space was so contradictory, or at least was not addressing the fact that the two very important public spaces in the city are constantly closed off to you know, 5-6 Biennales throughout the 2 years, and it's a closed off space. The Arsenale and the Giardini are most of the time closed.
Which is a public problem.
Well, maybe I'll just add in something positive.
I was very
It is draining the cities to some extent, but I also want to say how important it is for us to have those kinds of venues to showcase our work. And I know there's a like proliferation of Biennales in the past decade all over the world, but just to practice as a researcher and in design disciplines where maybe a typical peer-reviewed paper is not maybe the best way you're going to be publishing your work, it becomes essential to have venues and venues like this where you can actually put your work out there.
I agree, specifically because there is a proliferation.
Yeah.
That model perhaps need to be rethought.
I agree
that the autonomy that one gets in terms of pursuing research or the desire to explore further knowledge, produce knowledge, the question at the end becomes at what expense, and if the city is suffering, and the people living there, and also you have to find the balance.
And is that the only form that could enable that kind of thing?
What kind of new forms?
Exactly.
I think my last question before we open to the public would be perhaps to go back to the title, which is G7, and then it's, you know, it's not really a question that meant to kind of brag about the abundance of G7 representation, say, but I think giving this large presence of the school, one thing as educators, researchers, thinkers, and creators, etc., if you can tell us about what do you think the school mandate, perhaps from an academic point of view, ought to be when it's offered such a platform? And also, I think that was clear across all the presentations, obviously each one of you is representing kind of a network, collaborative network of people that are from outside the school, whether it's scientists, activists, historians, etc. So what is the importance of perhaps also this interdisciplinary facet? The school, it seems that it's becoming kind of a vessel for it to happen. And I mean, that is it. It hasn't to be from a departmental perspective, or maybe from a general school philosophy.
Okay, it's actually funny, this is the second, for Nora and me, it's the second debate we're participating in for school. The first one was actually in Venice, and it was a CCCP, so even more particular, it's like a tiny program. Where we have 10 grads per year, and there were actually four people who were deeply involved in the Biennale, so that was Candela and Marina were also there. So yeah, you know, it's a hard question because it feels like G7 is just involved in everything and stuff like that.
It's a responsibility that's here, it's been handed to the school, so I think it's a good time perhaps to collectively think about it. I know the project has its own stories, but as we sit here as the G-Staff faculty alumni, I think it could be interesting perhaps to hear what you think of the school.
The question is for you. What did you observe in terms of similarities, or where do you think that the school has, you know, has created something?
I mean, there are obviously general topics, yeah. Maybe you guys can expand on, you know, the questions, the larger questions of obviously of climate change, but also from social inequality, freedom of speech, etc. All these kind of topics I see that there are probably in the business studios or the school and taken on seriously, and thought of in terms of spatial practices and how and policies, etc.
No, I was just going to say that I also felt like there's some kind of infusion of GSAP that's sort of went through multiple exhibits, and I think it was a testament to just, I feel a strength of GSAP is where we are now, is that there is kind of a strong diversity or biodiversity of approaches. It's not like, you know, there's, you know, a school, you know, a physical or formal way that the school is pushing. Maybe that was that way in the 80s or something, but and now it's just more about the spirit of inquiry and questioning. I think that kind of becomes the more pervasive piece. And also, I would say that Columbia itself identifies as being in New York, but also a global institution, in the fact that our students are from all over the world, and we have a strong position relative to global thought and global action, and so I sort of feel like that was, in particular this year, at Biennale was just explored as like this cross-cutting exhibition. You can see from the diversity of the work, it's not the same piece replicated, but it's from data, it's from salt marsh, it's from, you know, architectural history, and all these different facets are kind of coming together, but it's still the spirit of questioning that's kind of cutting it.
Yeah, Kate's mentioned something, but I want to to add another small piece. I mean, in addition to collaborations with you and Studio X and so on, there was, you know, for my process curating the pavilion was an immense support that was, you know, both existing but also from the past, that I felt come very strongly from the CCCP program, the Critical Curatorial Conceptual Practices program. Also with collaboration, very close collaboration with Vincent, who was also a graduate of the program. And I think one of the main things that you come out with is a kind of the dedication to non-compromising work, I think.
Taking the position that's here
and the forefront. Just something about that since you were in particular our year, we went to Venice 4 years ago and spent a whole month there studying the Biennale, and you know, everyone's different projects, we made a publication, and actually it was really sweet because this year we students did it again, and then they did a series of conversations, they paired up people who didn't know each other, or they did it but on blind dates. So there's kind of an active interrogation of the Biennale format itself done by the school, in a sense.
The meta question
is present too.
I think it also speaks to, you know, we were just mentioning a minute ago that the Biennale is a place to sort of showcase projects that don't necessarily become enacted as, you know, actual architectural pieces. And the fact that Giuseppe was so represented there sort of speaks to that kind of diversity of practice that occupies that space that the school sort of fosters and produces, and so it sort of reflects the relationship that's going on there. But on another note, we involve some students in the actual work of our piece, not very many GCSEP students, in fact. And I think it's really interesting and logical what CCP has done to sort of promote this kind of active engagement with the Biennale forum and questioning that. But I think that it's something in general that could happen more at the school than currently, sort of alumni.
Okay, thank you. I think I will open the floor. I mean, if you guys have any questions, if you don't have a good time.
I have a question for Alberto. Your work is fantastic. What happened? So, ecosystem services, one of the things that went well through all the presentations to me was the power of narrative, particularly when it's attached to the place. And ecosystem services, people can sort of build back into their sense of identity and their narrative of the place. Specifically, people can be like really attached to wetlands. They don't want them to go away, even though those landscapes are dynamic and say tidal flats or some other coastal habitat can be provide just as many ecosystem services. So what, I'm just looking for some of your perspective on how you not get stuck on one specific set of ecosystem services and allow that dynamic coastal landscape to evolve.
Sorry, I think just the final question.
So what happens when people become too fixed, come to rely on wetlands too much? And
versus
if they change
other
over habitat. Time versus another coastal habitat, it could be equally as valuable.
Yeah, it's a good question, but first of all, I don't think people realize the ecosystem services they are benefiting from in the Venice Lagoon, and that's also an important feature of involving local citizens in conservation, because you can tell them about what really supports their welfare. But I think if the lagoon would become a sea, as it is actually becoming, of course that ecosystem would provide a very different ecosystem services that would be possibly equally useful to the people if they are willing to adapt. For example, you could fish marine species, and that's of course it's a matter of value systems, okay? It's a matter of political choices, in my opinion. It depends on what you want the future of that society to look like, because people will adapt. People has always adapted to changing conditions. It's just a matter of what they really want, and I don't think they're really in Venice, they're really thinking about this. For example, in Venice, nobody's really thinking about sea level rise, which is a bit paradoxical since the city is built on water. They have constructed these Mose dams, and that construction has ended the debate on climate change in Venice. While actually it's going to affect the lives of people in many different ways, and there should be more talk about that because people are not aware of this.
Any other questions?
I plan to go there 2 years. When would you say it's a good time to visit? Biennale in terms of the crowds?
Probably not. Probably November, right?